questions. Oh, yeah, from this side.
For Butch, since you guys started the studio and you started working at the studio itself, was it different for you when you got jobs producing at other studios? You kind of, did you ever feel like you were out of your element or something was just a little different being behind another control?
You know, I was very accustomed to SMART, obviously, because you just get used to the gear you're working with and the staff and the people around you. I had done some work like outside of Massive work with Die Kreuzen and a couple of bands in Chicago. I worked at CRC in Chicago. But it was really when I did Nevermind and I had to go to Sound City, it was the first time I really felt, I was kind of nervous going there because I knew the studio's history. I knew a lot of records had been made there, amazing records, but I had to fly out of my element, and I knew Nirvana, or I knew Kurt and Chris. I hadn't met Dave Grohl until I actually got there for the session, but the second I got there, it was much like SMART in a way. It was pretty bare bones. Sound City was not a very fancy studio, amazing tracking room, kind of like this in a way, just a really great live room. And they had an Eve console and a really simple but great mic collection. So there was not a lot of bullshit in there. It was just really bare bones. And very quickly, like the first day, I figured it out. You know, it's like, okay, I know how to do this. But and then I got more adept at that. I realized when you go into another environment, it's not really about the gear. You just have to figure out the space, really figure out the band, and just get what is the core of how you need to record them. So I became less intimidated after doing that. Never mind.
Yes.
Question for you, Frank. Actually.
Me?
Yeah. you mentioned in the film about just dropping in on sessions. Do you have any favorite stories like playing according with Killdozer or anything like that?
Well, I played according with Killdozer, and that was an overdub. It was just me and Butch. Killdozer, okay. Unfortunately, was not there.
Yeah.
That was Free Love in Amsterdam?
Yeah, Free Love in Amsterdam.
That was on our list. We wrote about 40 things on the list. Accordion. So I said, Frank, he was in town. Frank, come on, we need an accordion. And I killed Killdozer song. He said, okay, man. And the accordion part is fucking awesome. Frank played on like hundreds of sessions. Literally, he would be driving through town, stop by and go, he would always have his pedal steel or lap steel or his accordion or whatever, or sometimes his guitar. We go, dude, can you play on this? We were talking about, what was this song? We heard a band, we can't even figure out who it is. A song, if anybody here knows it, it's called Animal Radio. We did it probably in the 89 or so. And Frank played a squeeze box accordion all the way through, and the song is great, and we have no idea who it is. I just cannot remember. I know the song, but we can't remember who it is.
It's a great accordion. Needs to be wonderful.
Oh, thank you, Steve. That's very nice.
There is one song in the film that I don't know who the artist is. It was off like, you know, I've got about like 40 tracks that are unlabeled that just are in a folder that says Warp Tapes. And
hopefully they won't sue us when the band is out.
We'll give them a t-shirt and $25 like every other band. But anyway.
Wart interview tapes?
What about them?
Is that what you're referring to?
Oh, no. SMART, Mike Zirkle gave me a bunch of transferred analog files when I was working on the film. Ah. And one just says Wart tapes. And I think, you know, Butch and Steve used to make compilation analog masters of sessions that they were doing and bring them down to WRT, as you heard in the film, and go on Harry Rag's show. And so when we found the moldy archives, you know, these were in storage, they were in the flood, they went into storage in Wisconsin, they sat for numerous winters.
There was a disastrous flood at SMART, and a lot of equipment and tapes were destroyed.
So after years of being in a warehouse, they were baked, they were transferred, and I got them unlabeled. And one of those songs ended up in the movie.
There's, you know, one thing that Wendy touches on in the film, or Harry Rag talks about, Steve and I had a lot of side bands. I mean, we've been in Garbage. Steve was our roadie in Spooner, the band that Duke and I were in. And then we had a band called First Person with Phil Davis, who was the singer, one of the singers in Firetown. And in First Person, we wrote like 30 songs in 2 weeks, and we became sort of the de facto opening band at Merlin's for a while. We get $50 surge. Ledwith would call us up Bow Wow Wow would be played. We need opening band. Okay, we'll fucking do it, man. So we get $50, and we did a ton of opening gigs. But whenever a band, there'd be a session, a band was supposed to show up, and they would cancel. We go, well, we have a night off. So Steve and I would make up a band name, and we record a song. It would be Nurble Knurble or Rectal Drip or Doll Burper. We had all these bands, Secrets of Terror Castle. And they were all just whatever, as Steve says early in the film, we just wanted to record. It didn't even matter what the song was or what the name was. It was just, we have the studio. It was our clubhouse. There's no one here. Let's make a song, make some noise.